This is the GARP algorithm that stands for a genetic algorithm for rule set production, although Tom changed the name for rule set prediction. And this was developed in the 80s, early 90s by Dave Stockwell from Australia. And this is another machine learning procedure method that was invented for different problems, and it was implemented for niche modeling by Stockwell. But the general idea of the genetic algorithms is that they are these heuristic methods, or these trial and error methods, for looking for solutions of very complex problems, for which deterministic methods like traditional statistical methods are inefficient in the sense that could be large amounts of data for analysis. They are called genetic algorithms because they are inspired in the process of natural selection, evolutionary natural selection, in the sense that they evaluate a model, input some variation on the original models, and then selects the most fitted one and discards the ones that are not performing well. We will see all the steps that are involved in producing a niche model in the GARP system. One of the problems that I have seen in the development of this field is that more and more software are available, which is good, but because they have become very easy to use by general users, they become a black box. You don't know what is going on inside of the program. And this is the case for GARP. It was very popular like 5 to 10 years ago, and many people started to use it, but most of the people weren't knowledgeable about how it works, so they weren't very efficient users of this software. Well, the steps are as follows. You have a set of occurrence data. Let's say you have 100 data for one of your model. The first step is that you split that occurrences into two sets. One for running the whole model, the training set, and then the other set is for an external validation of the model. So you are not going to use that second set of points in any part of the process, but at the very end, just for validating the model. From your training data, that's the second step. The system resamples this data. Let's say you kept only 50 of the 100 points. It resamples these 50 points into 1250 presence data, and it takes from the rest of the study area where you don't have presences another 1250 pixels known as pseudo absences. It's assuming that in these areas you don't have presence of the species, it's an absence. So if you have a full set of 2500 points of presences and absences. It doesn't matter how many points you have in your initial set, your own points, you end up with 2500 points of presence and absence. Then it splits this whole set of 2500 points in half and use one half for training the model and the other half for an internal testing of the model. So the first step for creating the niche, properly the niche model, is that these internal training points are used to characterize the conditions in which you can find these presences and absences in the form of rules that it's called in GARP, which are these if-then statements, and it produces these rules under four different methods, three forms of climatic envelope, so envelopes, so, such as biofilm, and an implementation of a logistic regression. So, in a way, GARP is a meta algorithm because it uses other algorithms like these ones to produce the niche model, and then uses a genetic algorithm to modify these original rules. So it produces a set of tens, I don't know, could be 100 of these rules with the training points. Then it uses the internal validating points, which is called the test, that has it, to see how well these rules predict this set of validating points via a confusion matrix. We will see what is a confusion matrix, but in essence what it does is to see how many points of presence and absence are correctly predicted by this set of rules. Based on those scores, on the percentage of points well predicted of presences and absences, it gives like a qualification or a grade to each one of the rules, and builds, I told you, a set of tens or hundreds of these rules, sorted in terms of their performance. The rules that perform best are at the top, and so forth. Okay. Then it enters the genetic algorithm. The genetic algorithm what does is to input variation into these rules. See, for example, if we have here that the rule that says if temperature is between 10 and 20 Celsius degrees and precipitation is between 350 and 1200 and elevation is between 1000 and 2000, then the species is present. That's a rule. That's a climatic envelope. What the genetic algorithm does is to change these values in a random way, in a random fashion. Okay? There are different rules for changing the values. It doesn't matter. It could be by deletion, by translocation, etc. But the idea is to input some variation into these rules. And then what it does is that it reevaluates the performance of this new rule, this daughter rule. If the daughter rule performs better than the mother, then it substitutes this rule in the rule set, the whole rule set. Okay? If it doesn't, it just discards this new rule. So it repeats this process of rule generation, of rule of evaluation, of substitution and deletion for as many number of iterations as you set as a user, or until it converges, which means that it doesn't improve the whole performance of the rule set. If at the starting process, you will see that in each generation of the rule set, you will improve your prediction capacity. But there is a point in which you don't improve in this prediction capacity. It stops at that point. And it ends up with a set of these if-then rules that characterizes the conditions where the species is present and where the condition is the conditions where the species is absent. Then, with this set of rules, goes to the geographic space and asks to each one of the pixels if it meets the conditions established by the rules, and gives the classification of present or absent to each one of the pixels, depending on the conditions of on the environmental conditions of each one of the pixels. So the final product of a GARP modeling process is a binary map, a map that says the species is present or the species is absent. In contrast to what, for example, Maxim produces, a probability map. This is only a binary map. Well, there are two implementations of best of GARP so far. This is the best of GARP. This is a standalone software that we used to use through a lot in the last years. And there is an implementation, as you saw, in OpenModeler. Actually, in OpenModeler, there are four implementations of GARP. We are going to use the version implemented in OpenModeler. Well, there's something else that it's important for you to know. Because there are several random processes in the whole generation of an each model, since the very beginning, the splitting of the point randomly, then the generation of the rules also is a random process. Every time you run a model with GARP with exactly the same input data, you get a map, a different map, somehow different. So that could become a problem because you say, well, which of these bunch of maps are informative, or which one of these 100 maps is a good one, and which other is not good. So Rob Anderson and Daniel Yu and Town developed a method for selecting the models that are more informative based on the predictive capacity. The way this implementation works is based on the evaluation of the errors of the model. When you produce a model, there are two ways that the model can be wrong. When it fails to predict the presence, the known presence of species when a point falls outside of the prediction, that's called an omission error. And the other way it can fail is when it over-predicts, or it's failing to predict the absences. When the model says that the species should be present and there's an absence, okay, that's called the commission error. And that's evaluated in this confusion matrix. Well, we use this information to evaluate the quality